Made them in class, or it's great. By the way, don't write anything on the palms, because then you'd have to be palm reading. Sorry. Sorry, I couldn't resist. Couldn't resist. Palm Sunday has become one of my favorite Sundays for a variety of reasons. But I know I shared last year, but my niece, Charity, I don't know, it's probably been 6, 7 years ago, I'm not sure how many years now, was pretty much going to die. She got very, 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 very sick, and we thought she was going to die. She had the ECMO, the thing that comes out of your neck. I can't describe it all, but we were all down in San Jose or Palo Alto at the hospital, and decided to go to church because some of my sister's kids were singing in a choir on Palm Sunday. And I'm telling you, we walked into this church, and they were singing one of the Hosanna songs. And all of a sudden, it just hit me, and God just whispered in my ear, she's going to be okay. And she ended up pulling through, and she's a vibrant girl right now, running around and almost too fast. But praise God, it was healing there. And then last year, on Palm Sunday, I was preaching, and my dad was here. And it turns out it was the last time he could come and hear me. He lasted another month in his life, but it was kind of a special time. And I always look at this Sunday with anticipation. There's just something about this Sunday, getting ready for Easter, but what the meaning. So we're going to look at that this morning. If you'll turn in your Bibles to Matthew 21. We understand that at this time during Passover, Jerusalem would have been crowded with people. In fact, some say maybe as much as 2.5 million people were there at this time when Jesus was coming. They were there to celebrate the Passover. You know, when the children of Israel survived as the angel of death flew over the houses and God rescued them and delivered his people, and they were celebrating it. So this was the big celebration. There was excitement, anticipation of this day, even way back there. And that had happened 1,500 years before this event that we're going to read about this morning. It's called the triumphal entry. It's one of the events that in all four Gospels, it's recorded. All four Gospels, it's recorded. So it's really important, obviously, to the Gospel writers. It's just amazing. He had a huge crusade. I mean, upwards of 2.5 million. We're not really sure the numbers. But he had the opportunity to do something amazing. And let's read it and see what actually happens. Matthew 21. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem, and they came to Bethpage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied, and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of a burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." What a moment! The King has come. I want to look at four ways, four different points here. The first being, the King comes in peace. The King comes in peace. You know, there's anticipation was high. I don't know if you can sense this anticipation. Here they are, lots of people. They're there to celebrate the Passover, and Jesus comes, and he comes riding in as a king. Imagine the anticipation. I mean, his enemies were awaiting a chance to capture him. We read it in John 11:53. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. They were talking about all the signs he did, and they were the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were jealous. They were afraid that something was going to happen, and they didn't know what. So they had to control him, and they were going to put him to death. So they're looking for an opportunity. They know, and they're anticipating him coming into Jerusalem. So they're ready. They're ready to capture him. They're anticipating this, and many people. We're also anxiously awaiting him to declare himself as the king and Messiah, delivering them from the Roman government. Well, here's the final preparation that Jesus puts into place. Jesus is a God of order, and he ordered this, and it's amazing how this works. He instructs his disciples to borrow a donkey, a colt. And in fact, we read in Luke's version of this, Luke 19:30, he says, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering it you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here." Find a colt on which no one has ever sat. This colt was set aside for Jesus. There was a purpose for this colt. Not a very old donkey colt, but he was set aside for Jesus. And the interesting part is he tells the disciples to tell the owner, tell him the Lord needs them. Now, we don't know who the owners of the colt were. We don't know if they were followers of Jesus, and they knew when he said the Lord, oh, Jesus needs him, okay. But what we see is the word Lord in Greek is Kyrios, which is a strong word, but not a name. So they're not saying the Lord, as in Jesus needs him. They're saying a Lord. In other words, a master, one who is in control, one who has the right to all things. So even if these people weren't followers of Jesus, they would have said, well, a master, someone in charge who has the right to this donkey needs him. But what faithfulness to the owners to say, okay, take him. But again, Jesus set this up. God is a God of order. He set these pieces to work just perfectly. But my question, and it's C on your outline there, is why a donkey? Of all the things you could ride in on, why a donkey? A humble, lowly beast, as it says, a beast of burden. Why a donkey? Well, first of all, Matthew announces that this is to fulfill prophecy. You know that Jesus knew the Bible, obviously, and he always fulfilled prophecy. And this is from it's from Zechariah 9:9. "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So Jesus is fulfilling prophecy that was written many, many years ago. But he also gets this donkey for a reason. It's an announcement of peace. When you come riding in on a donkey, you're announcing, "I'm coming in peace." But he's also demonstrating that he's a king. Kings would come riding in and have an entourage before and after and people shouting. So he's coming in as a king, but a humble king in peace. But rulers usually came in prancing on a stallion. So Jesus did not come riding on a white charger to take over. He came in on a donkey as a symbol of humility. He is the peaceful king of the people of God, not a revolutionary ready to take over political interests. We might take that to heart a little bit. God is a God, not a revolutionary. He's a peaceful king. He's not interested in taking over the political side of things. He was coming peacefully to declare that he is a God of peace. But can't you hear the Roman soldiers? This would be interesting if you could hear them. Here's the strong, powerful soldiers. You know, they're looking, they're waiting for this. They've heard about Jesus. They're waiting for this guy to come riding in. Okay, so he comes. They're looking for him to ride in on something, and he comes in on a donkey. You know, they're probably, look at that wimp. We can take him. He's riding in on a donkey. Come on now. He can't be a king. Because no Roman ruler would ever ride in on a donkey. They would come on a black stallion. Ever seen a black stallion? The muscles of those horses just ripple. I mean, it shows power. And they would be followed by chariots upon thousands of people. That would be what a ruler and a king would ride in on. But Jesus came on a donkey, peacefully. However, let's not forget, if you flip your Bibles just a few pages back to Revelation, Jesus is coming again. And this time, Jesus will be riding on a white stallion, followed by tens of thousands of his saints, his church. We will be with him. Let's read that. Revelation 19, 11 through 16. Then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness, he judges and makes war. His eyes are like the flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has his name written on it that no one knows but himself. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on a white horse. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let's not forget that. In looking at this picture of him coming in on a donkey, this time he wasn't coming in as the king to take over. He was coming in for a very different reason that people had no idea. Only Jesus knew why he was coming to Jerusalem this last time. Well, let's move on. The king, the second point here, the king is acclaimed by the people. The king is acclaimed by the people. Now, I want to look at verse 6 of chapter 21, because this is a verse I think we skip over a lot. It's just sort of in there. The disciples went and did as Jesus directed them. Such a simple little verse. The disciples obeyed. They did what Jesus said. That's what disciples are supposed to do. It shouldn't be a shock to us. Jesus said, go find this colt. Tell him the Lord has need of him. The disciples did as they were supposed to. Then they threw their cloaks on the colt as a saddle. And then they gathered around him and came with him. I think they began to see what Jesus was doing. Not what he was really doing. But they began to see that Jesus was making a statement here. As a king riding in, and the disciples got excited. The people's hopeful acknowledge, is your second point there, B. The people's hopeful acknowledgement of his kingship. There was this anticipation, this hope. I don't know if you can sense this, but let me put it in another picture here. I am a big sports fan, specifically the San Francisco Giants. And I know they're not doing good right now, so don't you know. They're 1-5 at the moment. But in 2014, they went to the World Series, the biggest games on the stage of baseball, and it was Game 7. And when you're listening or watching, at that moment, the anticipation, the hope is so intense. If you're not a sports fan, you may not get this, but for those, any sort of a sport, it's so intense that every single pitch, you're just waiting. And the announcer talks about the pitch and what happens. And you're anticipating because at one moment, one crack of the bat or one strikeout, World Series, they're champions. Okay, and so here it is, Game 7, and I'm just, I'm just sitting there, and the intensity and the anticipation is real, waiting for something to happen. That's what this was like. The anticipation for these people was huge. They are waiting for their king to come and rescue them. They have been burdened by the Roman government for so long. And Jesus has been performing miracles, and he's been doing this and that. Now he's coming in, riding on a donkey, proclaiming himself to be king. Can you imagine? Can you just feel that for a moment? If there's ever been anything that you just can't wait, you know something's going to happen, and you just can't wait. That's what was happening here. But they had no carpets, no red carpets to roll out, you know, like we might do nowadays. So people in the large crowd began to spread their cloaks, their jackets on the ground, and then palm branches. We learned that they're palm branches from John's version of this, John 12:13. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." So they were grabbing palm branches, the trees that were there, grabbing them, and they're laying them down. That's why we have palm branches around. The kids made palm branches. I've seen them all over the church today. It's been wonderful. And they laid them, signifying a king. This was a royal procession. There were people from Galilee, from all over the place, to celebrate the Passover. They were familiar with what he had done, all the things that he had done, all the healings, all the miracles, and they were ready. There was a hopeful acknowledgement. Okay, now he's done all this stuff. Now he's going to take over. Now my king is coming. Now he's going to rule. He's going to rule us and separate us from the Romans. I can't wait. But obviously, some of those same people, few days later, were very disappointed. That's not what he was coming for. We know what he was coming for, but many times their hope was maybe to cash in on this power, on this prophet, on this healer. This guy was going to take us and make America great. No, wait, was going to make Israel great again. Okay. This was the guy. He was going to do it. Many of us, the same thing happens today. There's a tendency within our hearts to cash in on Jesus' blessings, right? If you're expecting Jesus to be a good luck charm, I'm sorry, he's not. If you expect him to bless you financially, physically, socially, vocationally, you'll be disappointed when things don't go your way. It's not that he doesn't. Sometimes he blesses us financially, sometimes physically, sometimes socially, sometimes vocationally. But that's not what he was there for. That's not what he has come for. That's not who he is. And we sometimes have the same model that the people did many, many years ago, waiting for him to do something for me. And he actually was doing something for me, but I didn't get it, and they didn't get it. Picture this. It's Sunday morning. Time for the electronic church in America. Thousands lounge in their living rooms watching television. Almost every channel carries a religious program. Some preachers proclaim a clear-cut gospel message. Others, however, pace before an enraptured audience, telling them that Jesus will heal all their diseases and make them rich. He wants you well. Poverty is of the devil, shouts the preacher, as a swelling of applause picks up where he leaves off. People love the gospel of prosperity and deliverance from sickness. It's no different than then. At that point, they were wanting to be rescued politically. Turn back the calendar to Sunday morning around AD 33. The city is Jerusalem. There's no TV. But there is a preacher, and he's stirring up the hopes of an excited crowd. For 3 years, he's been going about Judea and Galilee, healing the sick, feeding the hungry, and even raising the dead. Wow. Now he rides into Jerusalem on a colt, gladly receiving the acclaim of the crowd. But those who shout Hosanna are accepting him for what they think he will give them. not what he came to do. They want an earthly Messiah who will provide for their material wealth and health, not a Messiah who suffers, whose death on the cross will expose their sins, provide forgiveness, and a call for life of commitment. You see, Jesus was the only one that day. Jesus was the only one on Palm Sunday who knew what he came to do. Everyone else there thought he was there to release them, to free them. And that anticipation was so high, they had no idea that he truly was coming to free them from the chains of sin, much bigger than political, but they had no idea. So the third, the king is crowned with praise. They were praising God, is A there. They were praising God. They were shouting in loud voices, praising him for his mighty works. This would have been fun and exciting to be at. I like when people get excited and praise God and jump up and down. He fed the 5,000. He calmed the sea, turned water into wine, cast out demons, healed the sick, made blind to see, lame to walk, raised Lazarus from the dead. Can you imagine the emotions that are raising high right now? If there was ever an emotional service, a time to call people to make a decision, this was it. Jesus could have taken advantage of this, but he didn't. But they were shouting and rejoicing. As people walked along, some before Jesus and some behind him, further adding to the picture of a royal procession before and after him being in the middle, they were singing some of the pilgrim songs, Psalms, Hallel. Matthew noted that they repeatedly sang the words from Psalm 118, 25 and 26, which says, "Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord." They were shouting to Jesus, "Hosanna to the Son of David." Hosanna means save us. Save us. What were they wanting to be saved from again? The Roman government. Save us. It was an acknowledgement of power. They respected and knew he had power. What he said happened. It was a prayer of deliverance, although they were wanting deliverance from the Romans, not their own sins. But they called him the Son of David. It is identifying him of the royal line, recognizing him as the Messiah, who was to inherit the Davidic covenant and reign on an eternal throne forever and ever. They were claiming who he actually was. They also called him the one who comes in the name of the Lord. It's also another messianic title. In the psalm we read, they chanted at all the main festivals, carrying an implication of him as Messiah, and he comes as Yahweh's representative. They were chanting, "The one who comes in the name of the Lord, we know that you represent Yahweh." We're excited. Hosanna in the highest. That is a reference to the angels on high, or call upon. They're asking the heavens to join them in praising God for sending Jesus. All these designation references were that Jesus is Yahweh's representative. Yahweh's Messiah, Yahweh's Christ. They were, again, connecting him to their Messiah. All the prophecies in the Old Testament, they were connecting him to him. That was who was coming. But they missed why he was coming. Luke records that Jesus was saying the power of his entrance was so moving that had they not responded in praise, the very stones themselves would cry out. We read that at Luke 19, 39 and 40. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And he answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out." Again, such a moving, powerful, emotional anticipation of excitement that he's receiving the praise, and he's not turning it down as he normally did. He's allowing this worship and this praise that if they're quiet, the very rocks, the very stones, creation will proclaim who Jesus is, no matter what. If we miss out, that's our own fault. Jesus will be praised no matter what. Let's join in, as many of them did. Again, proclaiming him to be their earthly savior. Well, let's get to the final point here. The king is rejected. The king is rejected. Here is the king. Here's the anticipation. But as we just read, the Pharisees reject him as king. They saw all this, and then they told Jesus, tell your disciples, that's enough. We've heard enough. And of course, they didn't. But the Pharisees reject him as king. And then, as we know, the people reject him as king. We don't know how many were the same, although probably most of the same, that same week being in Jerusalem. And just a few days later, on that Friday, they kept shouting, crucify him, crucify him. Remember, Hosanna! Praise the one who comes in the name of Jesus, in the name of God, not Jesus. The same ones that were praising him, shouting, laying their cloaks down, the palm branches. A few days later, crucify him, crucify him. Monday, Sunday he came in on the donkey. Monday he cleansed the temple. Tuesday he taught in the city. Wednesday we don't have record. Maybe he stayed quiet that day. Thursday, the Last Supper, the arrest, the unjust trials. And Friday, he was crucified. If that's not an emotional week, I don't know what one is. He went from the highest of the high to the bottom in just days. Again, Jesus knew this all along. As he was entering Jerusalem that final time, he knew what he was coming for. His love pushed him there. He may have said, I don't want to go. Scripture doesn't say that. But inside his human might say, I don't want to go. His love for you and for me pushed him there to do what he had to do for you and for me. Again, we wonder how many of those same people were crying, crucify him, that also cried, Hosanna. Some people may have been disappointed, legitimately, maybe resentful. I mean, look, he didn't overthrow the Roman government. He didn't set up an earthly kingdom. After all, hadn't he created a golden opportunity? If this was an opportunity of all opportunities, this was it. He could have set up his kingdom. He could have called a call to arms. He could have called all those people to say, here we go, we're taking over. They must have been let down. Because by the time Friday comes and he didn't do any of that, oh, man. Well, crucify him. He's nothing. What a change in the people. What they failed to recognize was that before he could exert his outward sovereignties, which they wanted, he had to rule in the inner citadel of every man's heart. He had to. The greatest need of every Jew was not freedom from Caesar's legion, but release from the chains of their sin. We need that more than anything. We don't need freedom from government. We don't need any particular government to take over or not take over or back and forth. We need the freedom from the chains of sin. Jesus would rule, will rule, in power and glory one day. But first, he had to pay the penalty for sin on the cross. That's what makes this week so powerful. As you study it day by day and you picture the exuberance, the excitement, the passion of Sunday. But the passion of Jesus was to release you and I from our sins. Because he loves us in spite of how much we were his enemies. I don't understand that myself. I don't understand how you can come in and the same people that are cheering you, then crucifying you, and you forgive them. But that's what he had to do. But don't forget, as we read earlier, he's coming back. We have to keep that in mind. He's coming back, and he's coming on a white horse, and he's coming with a sword in his mouth, and he's coming to do everything that we anticipate for him to do. He's going to rule the nations. He's going to take care of sin. He already did take care of sin. He's going to take care of everything. And we, those of us who trust in him, will be with him. That's the excitement. That's the anticipation. I still feel that anticipation, if you can't tell. I get so excited. Sometimes I just sit there and I can't wait for you to come back. I just can't wait for that picture. I want to see. And then I think of my dad often. Oh, man, he sees it already. I'm jealous. Not that I want to die, but I'm jealous. I want to see Jesus rule and reign as he will. And he already does, but when we actually get to see that, don't forget that he will. But the question of the day that I want to leave you with is the same question that is asked in verse 10 of this passage. When it says, and he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up saying, who is this? Man, that's the question. Who is Jesus? I mean, he could stir us up. He can die on the cross. But who is he? That's what you and I have to answer in our own hearts. Who is he? Is he just a good man? Is he just a good man that rode in and died on the cross? And some say he rose from the dead and yada, yada, yada. Or is he Lord? Is he the King of Kings? The one we sing about, the one we worship? Now is the day to decide that. Who is he? You can't sit in the middle. You can't sit on the fence. That's not an acceptable answer. You've got to decide in your own heart, who is Jesus? He's the one that changes everything, and he's amazing. I invite you this morning, make him Lord of your life. Invite him to be Lord of your life. If you never have, or if you're confused whether you have or not, just tell him. He's an amazing God that will listen to you. Just tell him that you want him to be Lord of your life, forgive you of your sins. Thank him for dying on the cross. Thank him for coming into Jerusalem that final time. There is, although, one more time. And I always like to end with this Revelation passage. Revelation 21. This is the picture of what we can look forward to. Revelation 19 is when he comes back as authority. Revelation 21 is what's after that. It's what we get to have the rest of our eternity. Revelation 21, 1-7, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And he said this, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. That is our future because Jesus rode in on a donkey on Palm Sunday to go to the cross, to humiliate himself, to die for you and for me, and to give us his righteousness that we can now stand with him in heaven for eternity and worship him. I hope that excites you. That is what this is all about. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for this message. I thank you for this passage. And most of all, God, I thank you for sending your son, Jesus. What passion, what excitement, what a story of you, what you went through that final week. Jesus, thank you for going all the way. Thank you that you're not like me. I would have wimped out. God, thank you so much for going to the cross.